Today here on Rumblestrip.NET and 10-minute test drive, we finally get to drive a car that's fun. After a slew of SUVs, we have something that we want to drive. Today we're having a look at the 2018 VW Golf R. This is the mid-cycle refresh on this, the Mk 7.5. Europe's had it for a little bit. We're finally getting it here in the US. So the question everyone's gonna have is Golf R, Focus RS, Subaru STI, WRX STI, or now the Honda Type R? Which one should you choose? We got an answer for you. And that's what we're gonna find out on this episode of Rumblestrip.net and 10-minute test drive. So we've had a couple goes driving the Golf R in the past. And fundamentally the car is the same as the traditional Mk 7 or the 2016-2017 Golf R, in the sense of still has the 2-liter turbo with 292 horsepower, 280 foot-pounds of torque. It has the 4-motion all-wheel drive system, which is a front bias system, and then can move 50% of the power back to the rear wheels if and when needed. This one is equipped with the 6-speed auto. We've never driven the DSG version of this. The two other times we had to drive this, which was Seattle, 18 months ago now, I guess? And just like a 15, 20 minute drive in that on some surface streets. Enjoyed it, weren't sure about it. Last year at the Mama Spring Rally, we got to drive it, for the one lap around the track, which I think we have a video for, and if we do, we'll link it up here. And then also on the autocross track, and did okay with that, but the clutch was having some issues. So anyways, this is the first time we've had a chance to experience it in detail and depth for any kind of length of time. We've had it for a week. We've not put as many miles on this as we've wanted to, and that's completely our fault. That said, in the miles that we have put onto it, we think we've come up with some pretty good conclusions and some pretty good answers for the questions we brought up in the opening, which is we're in a time frame which we have not seen maybe ever in the United States of some superior premium hot hatches in the performance realm. Like we said, you have the Golf R, you have the Focus RS, the WRX STI, which, okay, it's not a hot hatch, but it's still the same segment. And then, of course, now the Civic Type R, which some will say, well, it's not all-wheel drive, so it doesn't count, but it's still a 300-horsepower hot hatch, so yes, it does. And as we said, we'll get to the point of what should you choose, what would we choose? And the answers will and won't surprise you. How's that? So let's get this out of the way. 7-speed DSG or 6-speed manual? Honestly, 6-1, half a dozen the other. And the reason I say that is this. Is the manual probably more enjoyable to drive? Yes, of course. At least that would be our opinion. If you're going to be doing a lot of track work, or if your commute involves a ton of stop-and-go driving, DSG all the way. The DSG is going to be quicker as far as acceleration. It's going to be quicker on the track just because of physics and things like that. We have not had any issues driving the 6-speed manual. It's perfectly fine, and this is probably the one that we would choose if we were to order it, as much as like the DSG. The other side of the equation is we may have to go with the DSG, because if my wife ever had to drive this car, if we were to buy it, she can't drive a manual, not just because she doesn't know how, but she has some medical conditions. She has MS, so she doesn't always have the best feel in her feet, so trying to balance clutch and all that doesn't always go well for her. Wouldn't go well for her. She has enough... Anyways, enough of that. But the manual is fine. It's good. As I said, DSG, maybe. Honestly, if you had the DSG, wouldn't complain at all. The nice thing for the 2018 model year is that essentially the only choice you have in options is manual or DSG. That's it, which is cool. It comes fully equipped. Nothing really to choose. Thankfully, no sunroof on this. Keeps the weight not only down, but from a high center of gravity standpoint. The one thing we wish we could have in this is what you can get in Europe, but you can't get in the U.S. because it just comes fully equipped with leather interior or leatherette interior, is the cloth interior with the tartan inserts like you get in the GTI. Honestly, I'd prefer that. I really would. But this is what you have, so it is what it is. So this will sticker at just under 40 grand, at 39 and change before delivery and all that. And if you want the DSG, I believe it's a $1,200 option. We can annotate that for you. And that's it. That's all you have to do. Now, this does come with the new 12.3-inch display, all digital, which is similar to what we've seen in the Audis, but of course the Audi's going to be a little bit nicer because we've got to keep the premium level up in the premium, not model, but premium brand. That said, this has does a good job with the map, and you can increase and decrease the size of the gauges and have different bits of data fill in there. This also has the performance meter in here, which you can adjust for things like G's and I can't remember. We'll throw in a picture and you can see some of the things that you can do in it. The new 8-inch touchscreen for the telematics is great. It looks modern. Don't think that's going to look dated anytime soon. This has heated seats, fully two-sided heat, things like that. It's, again, fully equipped. So you look at 40 grand for this vehicle and you're like, 40 grand for a Golf? Really? That's absurd. To a point, you're correct. But it also comes with all the niceties you sort of expect at a $35,000 plus vehicle. And then you're paying a premium because. But then again, you look at everything else in the market. Focus RS is going to be 40 grand. A STI, close enough as makes no difference, 40 grand by the time you put two or three options in there that everyone's going to want to put in there. The Civic Type R, okay, is the bargain in that that can be had, if the dealer won't mark it up for you, for around 35, 36. Now, the advantage that the Civic Type R has, and I guess we should just start running down this, is that it's front-wheel drive only. Now, you say, well, how is that an advantage? Easy. When you look at the Golf Type R versus the GTI, you're looking at a couple hundred pounds extra weight. Well, extra weight is extra weight. It affects everything. Acceleration, handling, braking, it does. Fuel economy, it just affects everything. So the Civic Type R is much lighter being front-wheel drive. Now, there are those among you who say, well, but it's not going to handle as well. Well, okay, so you can't be as much of a ham-fisted driver in the Civic Type R. We've driven the Civic Type R again. We'll annotate it at Road America. And I got to tell you, the knuckle system they did, similar to the old Focus RS 500, I think it was, the European model, does an amazing job. There's almost no torque steer in that vehicle. It handles amazingly well. And that thing is just slick, and it's a Honda, and God, is that thing really, really good. But it has problems that aren't associated with front-wheel drive. So Focus RS, STI, and this, all-wheel drive, does it have advantages? Sure. But I don't see that as the thing that should sway you one way or the other. Unless, of course, we said, you're just a ham-fisted driver, and you need all-wheel drive to save you or correct for all the things that you can't do on your own.
So while the audio on the GoPro is not the best here, we wanted to demonstrate, if we can, the quality of the Fender audio stereo system and why we always recommend that you upgrade to it when you get a Volkswagen, if possible. So this is a song that's got pretty good range, and we won't play too long so that we don't get hit with copyright. So we have DCC set up in race, which you can have comfort, normal, or race. We've had it in race, and honestly, it's been, the suspension has not been overly harsh. It's been fine. We're going to run it here in comfort, and we'll keep you updated on that. Steering in normal, drive system in race keeps the throttle sharper. The adaptive front lighting system in normal, you can have that eco or race. Climate control. Engine sound we've had in race, and then we'll run up through the gears here. Hopefully you can see just how kind of fruity that that exhaust is. It's pretty good. So let's flip it around here. And for a four-cylinder, this thing actually sounds more kind of like old-school Audi five-cylinder, but... about 60 that quick. So, you know, I think this is rated at 5.5, 0 to 60. This doesn't have the greatest shove, all right? It doesn't like kick you in the ass, like pin you back. And you can definitely feel the turbo is, I want to say undersized, but it's maybe a little undersized in that it feels like it runs out of puff a little bit as you get to right about $6,000, and then there's really no reason to run it up to the 6,500 RPM red line at that point. It's just pull your gears, and then you'll drop right back into the middle of the power band at that point. You know, if this thing has a downside, it's that it just doesn't feel fast. It is fast, it's quick, it handles incredibly well, but it doesn't necessarily feel fast. Is that a problem? It kind of depends. And with that, I think we can go to where we put your four choices in this category. So it's been a while since I've driven an STI, and they could be better. We've driven in the past 9 months, we've driven a Focus RS and a Honda, the Civic Type R, and now this, this Golf R. So I think I have a pretty good handle on where everything slots in. And we'll try not to be throwing too many stereotypes in these choices, but, you know, stereotypes exist for a reason, mostly because on a majority of the point, or majority of the time, they're factual, they're true. So let's run through this from our personal standpoint. In fourth position, we would put the WRX STI. Why? It's not a five-door hatchback, so it loses some functionality that the other three have. It's a little cruder. Maybe you like that. Some will say, well, it's more raw, it's more pure, it's more true. No, it's just cruder. Subaru has begun to address that in some of their cars, and I think this next generation will be much better. And as far as an interior and just an overall quality interior and feel quality standpoint, I think it'll be better, but that's down the road. Now we come to the harder parts, because for us, the STI is clearly in fourth position. It's just, again, older chassis, the chassis is okay, older engine, just it needs a lot of updates for it. In third place, we are going to put the Civic Type R, but probably not for the reasons that you would expect. Well, half the reasons. Front wheel drive is not a factor. Could care less, right? The car drives amazingly well. The interior quality, it's a Honda, okay? It's just the quality is through the roof. It's fun to drive. In our brief experience with it, and hopefully we can get one to drive here later this spring or early in the summer, it lacks a little bit of emotional quality. It feels cold, but that's also very Honda. The Golf here is clinical, but it has a personality. The Civic Type R just doesn't feel like it has enough personality. And then, of course, there's the styling, which is really the biggest off-putter for us. Again, if you're a 13-year-old boy, it's probably amazing.
But as a late 40s gentleman, even in my 20s, I never dug the boy racer kind of look on all that stuff. Is it functional? Yes. If they cleaned it up, would it sway my views? No, I think, honestly, I'd still put it in third place, but there you have it. So now we're down to the two, and probably the two most people are going to argue on, Focus RS or Golf R. From a styling standpoint, we dig the Focus RS. It's just a cool-looking vehicle. It's boy racer, but sort of a sophisticated boy racer. I don't mind that at all. It drives really well. It has a sense of occasion because it feels a little on edge. But it feels like a $18,000 economy car once you're inside of it. They do a nice job of cleaning it up and doing what they can with it, but at the end of the day, it's an $18,000 economy car. Now, you could say the same thing about the Golf. The thing is, the Golf has always been a nicer vehicle inside and out than anything else in its class, and it still holds true. So when you bring it up to the standards where you're paying 40 grand for it, that continues to carry over. So we would pick the Focus RS second by just a hair. And the reason is personality, our personality. The Focus RS feels like it's on edge. And as a daily driver, if you're spending 40 grand as a normal person, it's probably going to be your only car. It's not going to be like you can have a commuter car and that's your fun car. That's probably your only car. And as a car to live with day to day, no, especially because of how rough that suspension is in normal day-to-day driving. Now, you can address that, but you're going to be spending anywhere between $2,000 and $5,000 to fix it. Where the Golf, and why we choose it number one, is this is a vehicle that you could have for your only vehicle live with every day, and it would be perfect because you can adjust the suspension. Just even in the race, it's fine. In comfort, it's been just this little bit here. You notice a difference. It's a little softer, a little nicer, and it's great. The functionality, five-door hatchback. It doesn't have as much personality as the Focus RS. This is true, but that's okay. I'll trade that because this has a higher level of sophistication, which on a test drive or owning it for the first 30 or 60 days probably won't matter to you. But if you're going to live with this on a day-to-day basis, it will matter. The Focus RS will wear on you. Look, go watch Matt Farah's videos about his Focus RS. And he hit, until he'd fixed the suspension, he would tell you that he had almost parked it because it wasn't really that fun to drive. It wore on him. It was exhausting to drive because it beat you up. This will not beat you up. It's not as maybe as exciting or maybe not as fun as the Focus RS, but as an overall package, it's much, much better. And if you want more horsepower because you don't think it has enough at 292 horsepower, look, a $700 ECU flash from APR, and then if you want to put a downpipe on it, you're close to 400 horsepower. And okay, in the world of the internet, 400 horsepower isn't enough to get up and make a cup of coffee for. I get it. Because it's the internet and no one has a clue. But for a day-to-day driver, 400 horsepower will get you in way more trouble than you will ever care to need to be in. So that's going to wrap it up for this. Love this vehicle. It's been enjoyable. 40 grand. Man, that's a tough pill to swallow. And as we said right now, could we afford a 40 grand car? No. No. I couldn't. But a 2 or 3 year old Golf R at maybe 30-32, that's maybe off lease or been taken care of, you make sure that's good. Yeah, absolutely. And if you're thinking about the Golf R and you're worried about VW reliability, they've come out, the 6 year, 72,000 mile warranty is good on this. So keep it for 3, 4, 5 years and get rid of it as long as it's under warranty. You shouldn't have any problems. So if you like what you've seen, give us a thumbs up. smash that like button. Yeah, no, sorry. I can't do that with a straight face. But like, share, subscribe, and give us your feedback. We'll see you next time on Rumblestrip.net and 10-Minute Test Drive.